Hallelujah. Oh, let's appreciate beautiful music, beautiful singing. Wow. How many of us need God? I need God. I need God. In this dark world, we all need God. Amen. Well, I want us to pray tonight. I want every single one of us to pray, and I want us to pray for wisdom and revelation. Amen. As we come before the Lord, as we come before His word, I want you to pray that God will give you wisdom and revelation. Wisdom and revelation through His word in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Revelation is God showing you something you didn't know up until today. Amen. Wisdom is God helping you to make the right decisions. Justice, judgment, that's wisdom. The right decisions for your life. Lift your voice, just yes, pray for just a minute. Just ask God, as we come before your word, give us wisdom, revelation, wisdom, revelation, wisdom, and revelation. Lord, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, wisdom and revelation, O God. Wisdom and revelation, O God, in the knowledge of you, Lord. As we come before your word, Lord, fill us, fill everybody with wisdom and revelation. Help us to understand things. Help us to receive instructions, justice, judgment, equity, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Through your word, through your word, reveal to us something we did not know up until today. In the name of Jesus. In the mighty in the name of Jesus.
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 Thank you,
thank
O God.
Thank you, O God.
Thank you,
thank
O God.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Father, thank you for this sweet opportunity before your word. Mighty Holy Spirit, speak to every single one of us. Grant unto us wisdom from your word. Reveal unto us things that we did not know about, that we need to know for our lives. We thank you. We bless you. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Wonderful. You may be seated. Wow, what a blessing to see everybody tonight. Tonight is a good night for the word of God. Can I get an amen? Yeah. So, I want to continue with our discussion on going deeper and doing more. Amen. Amen. Going deeper in your faith, going deeper in God, going deeper in Christ, so that we can do more for the Lord. Amen. Amen. And I'm on the path which is going deeper by building mighty foundations. Amen. Going, the Bible says in, I think, Psalm 11, verse 3, that if the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? What it means is that without foundations, a righteous person can do nothing. Do you get it? Some things we are not advanced in is because we don't have the right foundation. A good example is your foundation in mathematics wasn't so... Because of that, you couldn't do some things. So the same way the Bible is saying that without the right foundations or firm foundations in certain areas of our lives, we cannot do much. Seeing that we want to do more for the Lord, it's important that we build these foundations, which is we go deep in these things. Amen. So I'm talking about certain important foundations or certain important areas you must go deep in your Christian life. Okay? After this, I'm going to talk about the foundations on which the church is built on. This church is built on. Do you get it? I'm just starting with us, then we go to the church. Can I get an amen from you? So, the areas I'm talking about, it's in the book Going Deeper and Doing More. It's in page 1. Okay, page one. Okay, since you don't believe, let me read to you. Okay. Go deeper, chapter 6. Going deeper and build more. Okay? I read those scriptures to you before, so I'm here. It says, go deeper with a mighty foundation. Go deeper so you can build something great for the Lord. Tall, majestic structures are only possible by going deeper. Let us build a great church for God. Let us build a deep foundation of righteousness and biblical truths on which the great building God has given us to build will stand. Have you found in your book now? There are mighty foundations that you must not set aside. Then he begins to list the foundations. The mighty foundation of salvation through the blood of Jesus Christ and through the cross of Jesus Christ must never be belittled or sidelined. How many of you remember me talking about the foundation of salvation through the blood? You can't go to heaven by being a member of the church. Second one, it says, the mighty foundations of faithfulness and loyalty must be deeply rooted in the foundation. So that's another foundation that God giving us the chance, we will talk about the foundation of loyalty and faithfulness. A man is defined by this. And when I say man, I don't mean the male species of the Homo sapiens. I mean both species. Human being. And faithfulness. Thank you. May God send you help. It's the definition of a person's character. Unfaithfulness can be masked. Let me get it right. I've not had supper tonight. Masked. In any type of way, from spiritual way, financial way, physical, any type of way, at the end of the day, is the definition of a person's character. Whether you are faithful or not, or whether you are committed to something or not. It's simple and short. It's a character trait. It's something of the heart. Do you get it? It's one of the foundations we must do. But that's not, fortunately for you and I, that's not what we are talking about tonight. The third one is the foundation of evangelism. It must not be set aside. Okay? Every Christian must be into soul winning. Go ye therefore into the world and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ to all nations. It's not just for pastors, it's for every Christian. Okay? Then another one is the mighty foundation of teaching the word of God and sticking to the word of God must be deeply rooted in the church we are building and in your Christian life. Remember I talked about it? Yeah, the word of God. Your life must be built on the word of God, not your emotions. Not your emotions. There's no surer prophecy than the word of God. No, it's no sure. The surest prophecy is the word of God. I had a dream. Look, read the Bible. Read the Bible. Because how many of your dreams have you had that didn't come to pass? If you see, because we are spiritual people, it's important that we believe in dreams. But using probabilities and mathematics, if I were you, I wouldn't believe in my dreams. No, just by loss of probability. Because how many of you have had, at least since you were born, 1,000 dreams? Let's stay at 1,000. Please. Remember I told you the foundation of mathematics. How many of those 1,000 dreams have been prophetic? if it's 10 of them have been prophetic, it means only 1% of your dreams are true. And your whole life is based on 1%. If 100, it means 10%. It means 9 out of 10 times you are wrong. Let me not go there. Let's continue. Build your life on the word of God. I think in Acts 19, 10 and 11, the Bible talks about the church in Berea. That when Paul and Silas went there to preach, Paul made a comment. Yeah, he says, and then the verse 11, he says, these people were more noble. Verse 11, and these were more noble than those in Thessalonica. It means he compared the church in Berea to the church in Thessalonica. And he said that noble, this word noble, maybe we have to investigate it later, but it's something that they were better than that other church. Why? Because although they received the word happily and everything, when they went home, they searched the scriptures daily. Daily. Whether these things were so. A church that searches the scriptures daily is a stronger church. A Christian who searches the scripture daily is a stronger Christian than a Christian who just hears the scriptures, hears the word of God when the pastor preaches. Like, I am your Bible. Do I look like the Bible? Do I look like King James? I mean, let's be serious. Search the scriptures for yourself. Read the Bible for yourself. Search it. Know whether the things they are saying, are they true or false? You see, some things sound very scriptural. Like love is blind. A lot of people think it's in the Bible. Love is blind. Even I preached somewhere, as I said, as the Bible says in John chapter 8, verse 72, love is blind. They say, amen. So build your life and your Christian life with a deep foundation of the scriptures. Another one is the mighty foundation of tithes and offerings as a source of financing God's word must not be set aside. And that's what incidentally and coincidentally I want to talk about today. All right, Leviticus chapter 30, verse number 27, the Bible says, all the tithe of the land, whether it be of seed or of land or of fruit of the tree, it is the Lord and is holy unto the Lord. Amen. As a Christian, one of the firm foundations of your walk and your relationship with God is the principle of the tithe. I'm talking about tithe and offerings, but let's focus even on the tithe. The principle of the tithe. Bible says the tithe, which is a tenth of what gifts God gives you, belongs to God. It's for the Lord. Actually, all of you belongs to God. It's just that 10%, even all your money, 100% of your money belongs to God. It's just that 10% of the 100 is dedicated to him. I mean, all the things in my house belong to me. They belong to me. But there are some that I allow my children to use. Although it doesn't belong to them, it belongs to me, but they use it. That's how it is. Everything, all of you belongs to God. All your money belongs to God. But God allows you to use 90% to look after yourself. And he says, 10%, that one is special to me. Leave that one for me. Leave that one. You chop my money. Tell your neighbor, chop my money. No, please say it with strength. Say it with strength. Chop my money. But leave the 10% for me. That's it. Chop my money. But leave the 10% for me. Your neighbor is stubborn. Let's go into the Bible And let's look at how God sees the tithe. Okay? There are many different areas where the Bible talks about the tithe, but I want us to look at one special one in Joshua. Okay? Joshua chapter number 6. Many Christians downplay how important the tithe is to God. How important tithing and the tithe is to God. But when it comes to God, it's a very important principle which every Christian must accept and build their lives on. Now, in Joshua chapter number 6, the children of Israel are approaching the promise. I remember we read from Joshua 1. We read from Joshua 1. Moses had died, and Joshua was now in charge. And God was telling Joshua, be brave, be courageous, be strong, and take the children to the promised land. So Joshua did just that. Now, as they were going to the promised land and conquering the lands, they came across a city called Jericho. Now, Jericho was a well-fortified city, and nobody could conquer them. And the reason why nobody could conquer them was because they had a wall so thick and so high that you cannot get into the city. So they have spies on top of the wall and in windows. The walls were so mighty that people lived inside the walls. If you go to the Kodesh, you'll be there one day. If you go to the Kodesh, you will see this type of wall I'm talking about. That the wall, people live in the, there are restaurants in the wall. Restaurants inside the wall. People's homes inside the wall. Shops inside the wall. They are in the wall. Inside the wall. So if you ask, where do you live? I live in the wall. Yeah, so Rahab was living. I don't know if you remember the prostitute Rahab. She was here last. Anyway, she lived in the wall. She lived in the wall. Do you see? So, and it was very high. So the way they protected the city was they spy from the top and see when there's an enemy army marching against them, they close the gates. And once they close the gates, you can't climb over the wall. That's all. You can wait it outside the wall for days till your army finishes. Napoleon said the strength of an army depends on food, on their stomach. The greatest general of all time, Napoleon Bonaparte, an army marches on its stomach. Because as they are there, you have to feed them. So when you come up against Jericho, the question is, how long can you wait outside? Till your food finishes and your people start to die, you will go back home. How many of you have watched this movie, Troy? You remember Troy? They had a wall. Yeah, that's a good picture. But their walls are even slimmer. I'm talking about thick building tall walls. So God gave them an idea that this is how we are going to take down Jericho. When you get to Jericho, march around the city once a day for 6 days. Go around, let the priest and co, praise and worship leaders, Zenandi and co, let them blow the trumpet and march around the city. One, go again. Don't bring bulldozers. Just go around the city every day once. And on the seventh day, go around the city 7 times. And after the 7th time, the priest will blow the trumpet. And when you hear the trumpet, all the people should shout. And when they shout, the walls will come down. Hallelujah. So in verse 1, you even see how they defend. It says, now Jericho was straightly shut up because of the children of Israel. They knew they were coming. None went out and none went in. This is enough to defeat any army that is coming. They just shut it up. They make sure they have enough food inside. And you can't be carrying food. How much potatoes can you carry along when you are going to war? Onions. It will even rot. Do you get it? So that was the case. So let's go into the scriptures. So this is the secret God gave to them. And then it worked. Okay, so the Lord said, unto Joshua, see, I have given into thy hand, Jericho, and the king thereof, the mighty men of valor, and you shall compass about it, blah, 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 blah. Let's go down. So, verse number 17. So, this happened, okay, and Joshua is addressing the children of Israel. He says, and the city shall be accursed, even it, and all that are therein to the Lord. Only Rahab the harlot shall live, she and all that are in her household, because she hid the messengers that went in. She helped God's people. All right? So God had told them that, listen, after you conquer this land, the whole land shall be dedicated. This word accursed, the meaning of this word accursed here is dedicated or devoted. So God asked them, destroy everything for me. Everything. Dedicate it to me. The only thing that are the mighty men, the king, everybody, the only thing that shall live should be Rahab, because she helped my people and her household. That's all. Next verse. And ye in any wise keep yourselves from the accursed thing. Nobody should have any of the accursed, lest ye make yourselves accursed when ye take of the accursed thing and make the camp of Israel a curse and trouble it. So God said, that thing that I've said should be dedicated to me, nobody should take anything. Destroy everything. If you take something, it becomes a problem to you. But verse 19, but all the silver and the gold and the vessels of brass and iron are consecrated unto the Lord. They shall come into the treasury of the Lord. So he says, the silver and the gold, it should be for the Lord. That's it. Destroy everything and keep the silver and gold for the Lord. So they went in. Let's go. Let's jump a few scriptures. Verse 24. And they burned the city with fire and all that was therein, only the silver and the gold and the vessels of brass and of iron they put into the treasury of the Lord. And Joshua saved Rahab the harlot alive, and the father of the household, and it goes on and it goes on. So they conquered the place, and they kept the gold for the house of the Lord. Next chapter. They kept what was dedicated to God, okay? Next chapter, chapter 7. But the children of Israel committed a trespass in the accursed thing. What was set apart for the Lord, they committed it for Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah, of the tribe of Judah, took of the accursed thing. And anger, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against the children of Israel. He took the tithes for himself. Achan. And the Lord was angry. And the Lord, many of us, you chop your tithe, you say, oh, nothing. God, look, God doesn't joke with the tithe. God doesn't joke with it. He doesn't joke with it. Some of us are casual. We can chop it for 3 months. Some of you, when pastor asks you, that's when you pay it. Even the fact that I have to ask you is a message to you. That we have to do a record check and then an audit and inquiry, then ask you. But today's Christians are like that. Even some of you are watching me right now on a flat screen television. Joshua sent men to Jericho, from Jericho to, I don't know how to pronounce this word, which is I or AI or artificial intelligence, but whatever. They sent them to AI. This was a small city. The city was as small as its name. Its army had only 3,000 people or so. And they went to fight with these people. And the people whipped them and killed them. And Joshua was worried.
He sent men to go and spy the land. When they went, they said, oh, it's some small land, it's some smaller Nyana land. It's like that our place at around your workplace, what's it called? Jigajo. It's some small place. We just go and we wipe them off. But that's where they were defeated. Imagine when they defeated Jericho, everybody was afraid of them. But they went to artificial intelligence headquarters, AI, and they were defeated completely. So Joshua came to ask God. Verse 6, Joshua rent his clothes and fell on his face before the ark of the Lord until eventide. He and the elders of Israel and put dust upon his head. And Joshua said, alas, O God, wherefore hast thou at all brought this people over Jordan to deliver us into the hands of the Amorites to destroy us? Why have you brought us to deliver us to our enemies to destroy? Would to God we had been content and dwelt on the other side of the, would God have preferred for us to live on the other side of the Jordan? Oh Lord, what will I say when Israel turned their back before their enemies? For the Canaanites and the inhabitants of the land shall hear of it. What are the people going to say when they hear that we have been defeated so badly by AI? And the Lord said to Joshua, get thee up. Wherefore liest thou thus upon thy face? Why are you even lying? What is this? What is all this drama? What is all? You know, sometimes we are in the wrong and we start making drama. That's why I said, pray that God will reveal something to you that you didn't know. You are in the wrong. You see, if you didn't know what Achan had done, do you see? And you come and you see what Joshua is saying, you will feel that God has disappointed Israel. I mean, why should God do such a thing to Israel? Look, you have brought them to jail. Now you are letting small boys beat them and defeat them. Which God is this? So that's why Joshua was asking God, what will our enemies say? And also, God said, look, Joshua, stop this drama. What is this drama? Get up. What is this drama you are doing? You are making it look like I've done something bad against you. But you and I, let's look at the facts. He says, Israel has sinned and they have transgressed my commandment which I commanded them, for they have taken of the accursed thing and have also stolen and dissembled also. They've lied to me that they didn't take anything. They have put it even among their own staff. They've taken the tithe and they have mixed it with their own money. They've hidden it. It's like, oh, where is the tithe? Show me which one. Which one are you talking about? It's like they've taken the thing, they've stolen and they have mixed it with their money. So that when you come, you can't see which one. So I'm using it to pay my rent. I'm using it to pay my school fees. So they have mixed it. They take 2% of the tithe to top up the rent, 8% of the tithe for groceries, then another percent for food. So when you come, you can't see what they have used the tithe for. You see, if you could take this phone and say, they used the tithe to buy this phone, so let's return this one. Then you can say, they have lied about it. They perform a trick. So when you come, you can't point which one is the tithe. Use some to pay Mashonisa. Use some. They've hidden it amongst their staff. It's like when you come and you search for it, you can't find it. From today, stop hiding the tithe. Stop hiding the tithe. Hey! Build a firm foundation when it comes to your money and God. Win this battle, I'm telling you. Therefore, the children of Israel could not stand before their enemies. He explained to Joshua, this is the reason why you were beaten like thieves. This is why you couldn't fight your enemy. Because you, how you go and fight a nation, you just use praise and worship to defeat them. You should know that there's some supernatural power that makes you do things. So when that supernatural power is taken from there, you will become weak. Your true self will appear. It's like watching these children's cartoons where maybe the guy has a superpower. You see, like, I don't know, is it Superman? Kryptonite? No, or let's even, what does it take to get the powers? Like, how many of you watch The Mask? Like, when he puts on the mask, then the powers come. So it's like when you do the spiritual thing, then the powers come. When you don't do them, then the mask is gone. Then AI will be beating you. Even the person who has beaten you, when you go, they say, what is his name? You can't mention his name. You can't find him. Neither will I be with you anymore, except you destroy the accursed from amongst you. So God said, this is how it's going to be. Then God said, now let's do an investigation. I'm sure Joshua was arguing, oh, who has taken it? God said, let's do an investigation. This is why sometimes we keep tithe records. Okay. I'm talking about the tithe. Today I want to talk about six things that happen when you pay your tithe, if time allows me. But I'm talking about even the investigation that God put into looking for the tithe. In the morning, therefore, ye shall be brought according to your tribes. And it shall be that the tribe which the Lord taketh shall come. According to the families thereof. And the family which the Lord shall take shall come by household. And the household which the Lord shall take shall come man by man. God said, we are going to search everywhere for the tithe. And we are going to start tribe by tribe. Zulus here, Xhosas here, Ndebeles here, Sotus here, Africans here, Indians here. Everybody is going to come. Yeah, one by one. Everybody, tribe by tribe. And I'm going to choose one of them. And when I choose one tribe, that tribe will come, the rest of them will go home, and that tribe will come, and that tribe will stand family by family. Clan will analyze the data one by one, clan by clan. You mention your clan name. What's your clan name? Something, Sbabkul. Sbabkulus will be here. What's your clan name? Mabande. Mabandes will be here. You don't have a clan name. No, I'm talking about the Zulus. We have selected the Zulus. Yes, Zuma. Gamalala also. Gamalala, I know it. They will also stand here. Then we will go into the Gamalales. All the family, the Gamalala clan will stand and we will select the particular Gamalala family and choose that one person who has not paid the tithe and we'll find the tithe. Investigation after. Let's go on. You think God is just bragging? God is serious about the title. You'll be joking with it. Be joking with it. And it shall be that he that has taken the accursed thing shall be burnt with fire. He and all he had, because he had transgressed the covenant of the Lord, and because he has wrought folly, foolishness in Israel. So Joshua rose up early in the morning and brought Israel before their tribes. Tribe, and the tribe of Judah was taken. When they came, God looked at them and said, the Judah people look suspicious. They brought the Judah people. And he brought the family of Judah. And he took the family of Zahites. Of the Zahites. So the Zahite clan, they were pulled out from the family. Accuracy. Accurate word of knowledge.
Where am I even in the Bible?
And he brought the family of the Zahite and the man by man, and Zabdi was the king. So, you see, when it says man by man, it means every man and his family. So, Mr. Zabdi and his family were taken. You see, the Zahites were called. They are a group of families. Then they are from Judah. Then Mr. Zabdi was called out of Babu Zabdi. He was called out of that group. Babu Zabdi. Hey! And Zabdi was taken, verse 18. And he brought his household man by man. And Achan, the son of Kami, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah, of the tribe of Judah, was taken. This is to find where the tithe is. So I don't know where you have been hiding the tithe. To find it. To find it. FMB was taken. Then the branch at the mall. Then the account type. Then a particular account. Then the particular transaction was brought up. And Joshua said unto Achan, my son, give, I pray thee, glory to the Lord God of Israel, and make confession unto him. Tell us the truth. And tell me now what thou hast done. Hide it not from me. And Achan answered and said, indeed, I have sinned against the Lord God of Israel. And thus have I done. When I saw the spoils, a goodly Babylonish garment. You have used some to buy clothes. You have gone to buy vans with your tithe. You have used some to buy clothes and do your hair. Why do you think you always have headaches? You are wearing the tithe in your hair. And 200 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold of 50 shekels weight. Some have used some to buy chains and earrings. Shamola patoleando la katasa. Then I coveted them and took them, and behold, they are hid in the earth in the midst of my tent, and the silver under it. Then Joshua sent messengers to run quickly to the tent, and behold, it was hid in the tent. Verse 9, and he took them out of the midst of them, brought it to Joshua and unto the children of Israel, and laid it before the Lord. And Joshua and all Israel with him took Achan the son of Zerah, and the silver and the garment and the wedge of gold and the sons and his daughters and his oxen and his asses and his sheep and his tent and all he had, and they brought them into the valley of Achor. And Joshua said, why didst thou trouble us? The Lord shall trouble thee this day. And all Israel stoned him with stones and burned them with fire after they had stoned them with stones. And they raised over him a great heap of stones that day. So the Lord turned from the fierceness of his anger. Wherefore the name of the place was called the Valley of Achor unto this day. Church of God, when it comes to the tithe, it's a very serious thing to God. It's a very serious thing to God. And without a solid foundation in that, you'll always be on God's anger side. As we can see from. Look at the amount of investigation that we have to go into. Because usually people don't tell the truth. Never believe what people tell you on face value. Never. You are a child. I said you are what? Yeah. Even let me say it in English. You are a children. you are not just one child. A lot of children put together. Or a lot of childs put together, you are a children. It's like your childishness is a lot. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, he told me so. I believe. Kai. You are not experienced. Wait till you are experienced. Wait. When you are experienced, you will see that. And all men speak of their own godliness. Every man will proclaim their own godliness. So they will always mask it in something. They will always say it in a certain way. Give it time. Time reveals all truth. Anyway, you don't believe me, so let me go on to the stage. Like Archbishop Duncan Williams said, vindication is in the womb of time. Just let time play out. Now, what happens when you pay your tithe in the speed of light? Because I don't want to be here next week. Number one, when you pay your tithe, you honor God. You honor God. Remember I said, tithe reveals your faithfulness. I'll come to that next week when I talk about faithfulness and loyalty. You honor God. Anybody who pays his tithe honors God. It means to honor means to show respect to. To show respect to somebody. I mean, Lady Pastor Yvonne's mom is here. Yeah, that's Lady Pastor Yvonne's mom is here. It's an honor. Respect. Your mother is here. Yeah, that's it. Show respect to the person. When it comes to God, the way you show him respect is by your tithe. A lot of our singing doesn't change anything. I was listening to my choir on Sunday, don't tell anybody. And they were singing. And we're all enjoying the singing. But as I was listening, I was saying in my head, Charlie, the music. So I said to Pastor Lungani, one day we'll have a music person. And the person will put together the voices. You see, like, not everybody who's in the kitchen will cook and the food will be nice. There may be active cooking, but there may be too much salt, too much pepper, too much. I mean, sometimes it happens to you. Do you get it? So they were singing too much. You see, what I felt was, maybe we have too many tenors or too many altos. Is it alto? Yeah, altos. And so it's not. There's no harmony. But zeal. Oh. Zeal. I tell you. 100% zeal. Happy and excited. I told Pastor Lugani, let's be happy. One day we'll have somebody who can mix it properly. So sometimes that's how our singing is. No, I mean, there's no harmony, and that's how you are trying to honor God. Tithe. Stop the argument. Tithe. You honor God. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9. They say, honor the Lord with your substance and the first fruit of your increase. Once there's an increase, honor God with it. Honor God with the tithe. When does the tithe come to play? When there's an increase. Remember this word increase. Anytime there's an increase, tithe is needed. Bishop, when do I pay my tithe? When there's an increase. When there's what? An increase. Honor the Lord with your substance and the first fruit of your increase. So when you tithe, you honor God. Every man, you honor God. To honor also means to recognize. So you recognize what God has done. That I hear Nasfas is 1650. That you were alive for the 30 days for the 1650 to come. That's it. So you are grateful to God. That you worked the whole month. I heard of somebody who was sick, wanted to take a day off. The boss said it will be on paid leave. He came with the sickness to work. You could have been sick not having leave days, and you will end the month and not have hours. Not have that income, but God saw you through for the month to end. Honor him. Number two, I said I'm giving you 6 or 7, so let's go with the speed of light. You remember God. Anytime you pay your tithe, you are remembering God. You do what? You remember God. Deuteronomy chapter number 8, the Bible says, beware when thou, that thou forget not the Lord thy God, verse 11. In not keeping his commands and his judgments and his statutes, which I command thee this day, lest when thou hast eaten and are full, and hast built goodly houses and dwelt therein, and when thy herds and thy flock multiply, like I said, whenever there's an increase, when your herd, your flock multiply, and thy silver and thy gold is multiplied, and all thou hast is multiplied. Once you have an increase, don't forget God. Then thy heart be lifted, and thou forget the Lord thy God, which brought thee out of the land of Egypt, and so on and so forth. So you remember God. Some of us remember God only when we are in trouble. Yeah, you remember God when you are in trouble. And you start to ask him to remember you. But when your increase comes, you forget that God is there. That's when you start going for holidays at strange places. Start going to eat at places you normally wouldn't eat at. Yes, you are going to eat Chinese noodles. But you won't remember God. Number three. When you tithe, you worship God. This one is a long scripture. Deuteronomy 26, verse 1 through to verse number 10. It says, It shall be when thou comest into the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee for an inheritance, and possesseth it and dwelleth therein, thou shalt take of the first of all the fruit of the earth. You see the tithe again. Which thou shalt bring of the land that the Lord thy God giveth thee, and thou shalt put it in a basket, and thou shalt go to the place which the Lord shall choose to place his name there, and thou shalt go unto the priest that shall be in those days, and say unto him, I profess this day unto the Lord thy God that I have come unto this country, blah, 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 blah. And thou shalt, verse 10 says what? Verse 10. And thou shalt set it before the Lord thy God and worship before the Lord. Your tithe is a worship. Not your tears. In your presence, I am content. In your presence, I am content. In your presence, there is life, expressions of your love. Then you start to cry, and revelations of your power. In your presence, I can be a loud song of praise. Hey, shut up. Bring your tithe. It's a more solid worship. It's a more solid worship. You are now crying over in your presence. And you are crying. Even the crying is off key. The crying is off key. You are crying off key. Look, I've been a parent by the grace of God for 18 years and still counting. Do you get? And I've been a husband for 20 years and counting by the grace of God. Because of that, I know tears don't really mean anything. Two groups of people that their tears don't mean anything. Wives and children. Two groups of people, wives and children. It doesn't mean... Look, women have a knob. When they turn it, then the cry comes. If you like, I can call three people and ask them to cry now. They can cry now. You see, when the choir is singing and the choir director does this, then they sing a certain part. Yes, you can just do that. They will start to cry now for you. It doesn't mean anything. So don't even me, you can't deceive me with your crying. Then God. I said, look, I'm saying this based on 20 years experience and 18 years experience. Yes. If you, maybe you have more experience than me and you know that, you can tell me after church, I'll learn from you. But me, as far as I'm concerned, then they start to grow. Oh, okay, liars. So you are coming to trick God with a cry. Look, bring your tithe first and add the cry later. Number four. Haven't you seen your children? They'll be crying. Then they forget why they are crying. Then they'll be playing. Then later they'll remember. Then they start crying again. You said we should be moved by it. Please stop what you are doing. Stop.
I've changed.
They are around you, eh? It's like they are crying. Then they see something. Then they forget that they were crying. Then they'll come and do. Then later they remember, I was crying. Then they come back into. Ah, please. Ah. Look, sometimes they'll cry. Then they'll look. If you are looking, please. Wake up. Then they'll continue that cry. God knows that you are like that. So you use your tithe to worship him. Use your tithe to worship him. Number four, you show that you respect holy things. You show that you respect holy things. When you tithe, you show that you have reverence for holy things. Leviticus 27:32 says, and concerning the tithe of the head and of the flock, even whatsoever passeth under the rod, the tenth shall be holy unto the Lord. He shall not search whether it be good or it be bad. Somebody should remind me about this one. Neither shall ye change it. And if you change it at all, then both it and the change thereof shall be holy unto the Lord. It shall not be redeemed. When you pay your tithe, you show that you have respect for holy things. Many people don't respect sacred things. They don't respect holy things. And one of the things we don't respect is God, the tithe. So when you tithe, it's a sign that I respect holy things. And he says, you shall not search it, whether it's good or bad. One of the reasons why people don't pay tithe is two reasons in one. One is sometimes it's too small. I only got 20 rands. God says it's none of your business. You shall not search it, whether it's good or bad. It's none of your business, whether it's small or good. The second one is when it's a lot. When it's a lot. Hey, this tithe, I have to pay 5,000 rands tithe. What do you mean? Are you trying to say God cannot count? You can count 50,000, but God cannot count 5,000. I mean, God cannot count. You can count 50,000, but God cannot count 5,000. He says, don't search it. Don't try to even investigate it. Whether it's big, whether it's small, whether it's good, whether it's none of your business. Just bring it. Just bring it. What are they going to do with it? Just bring it. He says, don't even change it. And if you make a mistake and change it, the tithe and the change, all of them belong to God. The original tithe and the change, it also belongs to God. Like, if you come and mix your money with it, it belongs to God. Your money has been confiscated. Don't change it. Look. Don't search it. If you like, go and do Bible study on these verses. Don't search it. Don't start to look into, this one is coins. Hey, look, it's none of your business. If your tithe is coins, bring it. Is it yours? The person who's collecting, he hasn't complained. He says, bring it. Then you that you are bringing, he says, it's too small. And a lot of, you see, people have eaten a lot of tithe on the account of it's too small. It's too small. It's too small, so you eat 70 rands today. It's too small, then you eat 2 rands today. It's too small, then you eat 7 rands today. It's too small, then you eat 8. Over a period of time, by the time you realize you have eaten about 10,000 of tithe. 10,000 of tithe is too small. So he said, don't even search it. You just bring it. Don't even change it. Say, this one doesn't look good. No, just bring it. Just bring it. Number 5, I close. My time is up by a minute. Number 5 is what? Number 4 is respect. Number 3 is what? Worship. Okay, let me give you 5 and let's go home. You demonstrate faith in God. You show that you believe in God. Malachi 3:10, Bible says, bring ye all the tithe into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house. And he says, prove me. Prove me. Prove me. Herewith, if I will not open the windows of heaven and pour a blessing. And he said, try me. Try me with this. Show that you trust me with this. Just trust me with this and see what I will do. Sometimes we don't trust God. We don't have faith in God. God, month end is coming. I have to pay my rent. The way my landlord is looking at me. And by the month end, my money is not good. God said, try me. Show that you have faith in me and see what will happen. So anytime you bring your tithe, you are showing God that I have faith in you. I trust you. I'm proving you with this thing. I'm proving you with this. Test me with this thing. Show your faith in me with this thing. And you will see. May we build a solid foundation when it comes to our money and tithing. That it will never be a question when it comes to you. It's like, look, I you know, we all have some smaller nyana bad things that are not 100%. I mean, not everything is 100. Even your hairstyle is not 100, but not everything is 100. You don't you know? But let's be determined that it should be in other areas. As for tithe, no. You see, Bible says that but for fornication and uncleanness, let it not be once named amongst us. When it comes to some sins, you and they shouldn't use your name and the sin in the same sentence. It shouldn't come up. And the Bible talks about fornication. I'm also telling that when it comes to tithe, your name shouldn't, like people who don't pay, no, your name should, no! It shouldn't be, I'm going to check. If by mistake they ask, oh, have you paid your tithe? It shouldn't be, I'm going to check. Is that me, tithe? No, it's not possible. No, I don't need to check. It's not possible. So, go and check. I said, I won't go and check. It's not possible. It's not possible. I forgot. No. It's tithe. It's not. Tell your neighbor, it's not possible. Tithe. It's not possible. No. Never. Maybe coming to church late, but tithe. No. Yeah, maybe getting some scriptures wrong, but tithe. No. There's a person. Have you forgotten what happened to Achan? Please. No. What is this even? Why even? I tell you this story, I close. Now, there was a Nigerian guy who they were telling that, you see, I think it was a story of, say, let's have a, like for instance, if you are broke. The guy said, no, I'm never broke. So it's an example. It's like even in an example, I'm never broke. Not even in an example. Find another example, but broke, no. So even as an example, you should not tithe and you. It's not possible. Have a solid foundation. As I'm saying, it's not possible. Some of you can't say it. Because Not only is it possible, it's prevalent. But starting from today, I said starting from today, it shall never be said of you that you don't pay your tithe. When they said people who don't pay tithe, when it comes to you, it's not possible. It's not possible. Even in an example, even in film stars, you can't play a role as somebody who doesn't pay tithe. It won't suit you. You tell the campaign director or the Basanta leader that I can't play that role. It doesn't work with me. I won't know how to act it out. I don't know how to act as somebody who doesn't pay tithe. No, I don't know. I won't know what to do. I don't know what to say. I don't know how to do it. So we will teach you, we'll rehearse. You say, I'll forget the lies. Because it's not in my DNA, it's not in my vocabulary, it's not in my character trait. I don't do this thing. It is not possible. When it comes to me, it's not tithe. It's not possible. It's not possible. Yeah, I'll be here, God willing. Not this Sunday, but one Sunday. It's not possible. It's not possible. It's not possible. Starting from today. Starting from today. I said starting from today. Starting from today. The tithe. Yeah. I remember I was counseling a brother who had not paid tithe for some time. And the brother said to me that times have been difficult. I said, you are killing the very thing that will take you out of the difficult. You are killing the very thing that will take you out of this difficulty. Yeah. Yeah. The very thing that will get... I talked to another lady. I'm trying to fix some problems. I said, 10 months you have been trying to fix the problem. The problem is not fixed. Is it not clear to you that you can't fix the problem by yourself? It's only going to get worse. The earlier you start trusting God as the person to bring a solution, the better it will be for you. Because 10 months, you can't fix the problem. It's not possible for you to use your tithe to do your nails. It's not possible for you to use tithe to do your hair. It's not possible for you to use tithe to buy clothes. It's not possible for you to use tithe to pay rent. It's not possible for you to use tithe to pay groceries. It's not possible for you to use tithe to buy fuel. It's not possible for you to use your tithe to go out chilling. It's not possible. It's not possible. It's not possible. We will honor God. We will show God respect from today. In the name of Jesus. Stand to your feet. Let's bring the service to a close. It's not possible. Lift your hands and declare that you and tithe is not possible that you will fail from today. From today. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Believe it and declare it. God is sending you help.
Jesus.
God is sending
Thank
you help.
Your God. It's
God
not
is sending
possible.
You help. God
it
is sending
not
you help.
Possible, oh God.
God is sending you help.
In the mighty
God
name
is sending
of
you
Jesus.
Help. God is sending us help.
Among people who
in the name of Jesus. My God, help us to build faith in you, in your ability to keep us, in your ability to preserve us, in your ability to look after us and watch over us. In the name of Jesus, let us honor that which is holy, holy before you, Lord, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Lift your hands, let's pray. Father, thank you for every hand lifted up.
Thank you, oh God.
Thank you for every family, every tribe represented by these hands. We pray. Lord, have mercy on us. Anytime we have mistakenly spent our tithe, today we ask for mercy.
we begin a new page from today. From today, let all of us honor you with our tithes and our offerings. Let us not move away or shift from these mighty this foundation of God. In the name of Jesus, we thank you. We bless you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Oh, put your hands together for the Lord. Maybe you are here tonight, you want to say, Pastor, please pray with me. I want Jesus to come into my heart, to be my Lord. Your relationship with God starts from there. You want me to pray with you? I want you to lift up your right hand wherever you are standing. I'll pray with you, Pastor. Please pray with me. I want Jesus to come into my heart, to be my Lord, and to be my Savior. If you are here like that, I want to pray with you. Lift up your right hand with me. I'll pray with you. Say with me, dear Lord Jesus, everybody. I come to you tonight.
I come to you tonight.
Just as I am.
Just as I am.
I'm a sinner.
I'm a sinner.
Please forgive me of all my sins.
Please forgive me of my sins.
I believe you died for me.
I believe you died for me.
And you rose again.
And you rose again.
I confess
that
from today.
That from today.
Jesus is the Lord of my life.
Is the Lord of my life.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
For dying to save me.
For dying to save me.
Amen.
Amen.
Why don't you appreciate the Lord with a hand clap?